Okay. Welcome to the January 25th, 2017 Deerfield Selectboard and Board of Health meeting. We have the minutes of January 5th, and I had them here somewhere. Did anyone have a chance to?
I did read them.
Okay.
Read them as well.
And you all are willing to make a?
I make a motion that we accept the minutes as written.
Okay. Would you second that?
I second that.
Is there further discussion?
No.
Nope.
Okay. Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Perfect. Thank you, Wendy, for doing the minutes. It was so nice of you.
I'd say it was my pleasure, but it wasn't.
Next item on the agenda is we have just the MMA annual meeting debrief.
Yeah.
The good news is the governor is proposing a 3.9% increase in the discretionary local aid. So
I have some that just hot off the press.
Oh, great.
Okay.
The
perfect.
Cherry sheets reflecting what he is.
Nice.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's the 25th.
And
that's right.
That is
coming out
for
today.
The town, and this is for Frontier.
Oh, good.
Eight. I did hear that he increased the school aid budget.
$20 a child?
It was 2% in school aid, which is works out to be about $20. So that was went from we gained $11,000. So you know that's okay.
Take it.
Frontier is one page.
Okay.
And,
thank you.
Okay, I need it.
Why did our cherry sheet go down? Our cherry sheet actually went down.
From
wait
where?
A second.
Because of charter school sending tuition.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
my
wait,
God.
Sorry, I didn't get the wrong line. Because, look, where
school
is
choice
that?
Receiving tuition. Yeah.
Yes.
So we're actually $200,000 short.
Yep.
How does that happen?
School
oh,
choice.
God. We've got to.
School choice has gone down. Dramatically.
Okay. Well, we're going to have to sort this out, guys.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, in general, there was no cut so far. The only thing that makes me a little nervous is that their revenues are a little soft. Yeah. So that gives the governor the ability to do 9C cuts. That means mid-year cuts. So that could be a little bit tough. Good guy Trevor and I sat in the front of the meeting, one of the meetings, and we had the Lieutenant Governor Polito tell us how wonderful they're going to give us more money for community compact. So
yep.
I made sure we attacked her and said thank you very much for the mosquito district money, planning money, and we will be hitting her up for implementation money. And we appreciated her and we invited her out to a
yep.
meeting. So maybe we will have some more support for the state because we have a March 15th meeting where the state reclamation board will vote to allow us to proceed. So not saying that we can have a district, but that we can proceed. So that was positive. There was $2.8 million for local aid, local technical assistance, and $2 million for community IT that Trevor's going to be pursued. The Attorney General also okayed the local zoning laws, bylaws that imposes temporary moratoriums for recreational marijuana. I'm going fast because of our public hearing. But another thing that came up is the GABSBI. That's the Governmental Accounting Standards Board 74 and 75 recommends changes on how the municipalities report their OPEB liability, which is your other post-employment benefits. As you know, we've had multiple discussions over the years on how much we should be putting away, which we have not been putting away. And their contention is there's been little attention paid to the OPEB municipal liability and the lack of towns putting stuff away. So there will be a mandate at some point. So part of our budget process, we actually should be putting some OPEB aside just so it's not a shocker. I guess for me, I know Trevor will want to talk about some things, but for me, one of the biggest things over the weekend was climate change. I went to a couple of climate change type workshops, and whereas we've been focused on adaptation, in other words, the culverts keep blowing out, the roads keep blowing out, and we can't keep replacing them because we're going to be bankrupt, so we try to replace them in a way that will withstand climate change events, these extreme intense events that we have. It was really interesting for both Trevor and I, because we both went to that one, when they talked about we really have to do mitigation. And this is one of the charts, and we'll, maybe we can come back to it if we have time. Yeah. But we've got to do both. And again, we've been focused on adaptation because it was costing us so much money, but mitigation means with things that we got to do. We got to focus and follow up on the solar panels at the landfill.
Right.
We got to make sure KIPP was really good. One of the vehicles that we replaced this year is, you know, more efficient. We've got to do stuff in our own community, and I think the news kind of just makes you feel like you've got to act on a local level. And so I think some of the recommendations came up. I have a whole list in the back, but some of the recommendations that they came up that we needed to do, strategies, I think we have to focus on both here in our community and focus on the footprint, which I have to say myself, I haven't been focused on.
Right.
One of the other workshops I went to was strategies in municipal emergency management. And it was very, very interesting for town manager in Scituate and the fire chief in Duxbury. They both have extreme events all the time because they're north-facing harbors, so they get the nor'easter like this weekend. Mm-hmm. And that there was some Twitter, some social media suggestions and some different things that was that we that I have multiple notes on that I thought was pretty good. And then the other workshop that I went to, Tim Corey was one of the presenters. He's a stream continuity specialist in the Division of Ecological Restoration, and there is money. There's about $8 million worth of money out there for some culvert replacement. And Kevin had already reached out to him. He had already come to Deerfield to work on our Mill Village, mm-hmm. and I followed up on him, and he did say that the habitat, we are, you know, when we rank high because of the habitat area, but the stream is not so viable. So I asked him to come back out, and we will work with him, and so we have some, that was good follow-up from
yeah.
Kevin's initial follow-up, and you know, he has come to our Resilient Communities group on the Deerfield Watershed, and there is a new report out saying that the Deerfield Watershed is one of the most unstable in mm-hmm. Massachusetts. So I brought that up to, I was made aware of it at the workshops and prior to this one. So when I talked to Tim, I said, you know, this is, how about this new study? And so he agreed, and that's why he's going to come back to town. So that was good.
I know I don't want to interrupt, but how does it mean it's unstable?
It has the most most chances of having you know, washouts and events, you know, because when we have those extreme events, we have, there's about 30,000 culverts in the Deerfield River watershed, and there's high percentage of those are undersized and not adequate, and so those are the ones that are continually getting blown out. And so when they say it's unstable, it's because of the gradient.
It's not in Deerfield. It's
no, but we're at the bottom.
Right.
So, and that's why we have the Resilient Communities group, because years ago I realized that we're at the bottom. We got the whole upstream. It doesn't matter what we do here. We've got to work on the whole stream. So that's what we've been doing, and Kevin has been trying to be savvy about this, and we've been working with the conservation district, and we have been. So anyway, there's a lot more stuff. I got to do this,
yeah.
But one of the big things was Pat Leavenworth. She's a chief engineer for MassDOT. She was there, and one of the things that she suggested is just get the printout from the state on their listed culverts and bridges and see if it actually matches what's real on the ground. And that's how you start
addressing.
Apply for this kind of thing.
I
so
see.
And so just
yeah, well, go, I'll hit it after.
No, no, go ahead. Just go ahead, because I
just found it really, really beneficial to go. I mean, it's my obviously first year going to the MMA and meeting selectmen from all over and listening to our senators and the governor speak. The classes were great, fantastic. Like I said, the climate change one was really eye-opening. Excellent scientists there and showing, you know, what we're doing is unsustainable and our kids are going to be paying the price for it. So I'm really curious about, again, mitigation. You know, obviously we have stuff that has to happen and we can't switch over fuels right away, but any way we can move to mitigate that with solar projects, you know, more ways to kind of get our hands around this and educate the public on what, you know, what's going on and what's coming down. There's going to be zero help federally, obviously, because they shut everything right off.
We were in the middle of the workshop, and they said that the
everything
EPA
went blank.
Was pulled down from the EPA website.
Even National Park Service went blank, so if you can't even tweet about a park. So hopefully that stuff will come back online pretty quick.
The bottom line is we need to stop burning so much fossil fuel, so
yes.
Maybe next year they should cancel the MMA thing and save
bingo, we should all come in on a train. I
anyway.
Looked at a way to get back at public transit from Boston.
Do you
it
want
was
that
take,
minutes?
I think, 23 hours, and the train went like
it's
this
true.
And this and this. But, yeah, we need better infrastructure, better ways of spending money.
Anyway, it is 7:47.
Six.
And we should need to do the community development strategy hearing.
6:49.
Well, I'm going to just, we need to, yeah, 6:49.
Okay. I mean, 6:49. What did I say? 7. I was looking at 7. I'm sorry. You're right. Okay. 6.
Okay.
47. I started talking about it at 6:47, Kip. Come on. All right. I was only 2 minutes late. I'm trying to run a tight meeting. There was just a lot to say.
Mm.
Okay. I just want to, just like Brian McHugh did at your former meeting, that's just signing in the public who's here. That would be great. Thank you. Would you like me to?
Yes, I was just going to say, Wendy, why don't, since you're actually hopefully on board effectively tonight,
Would
you feel comfortable having you run this?
Okay. Well, as you know, Brian McHugh was here from the Regional Housing Authority. I'm shortening their name to talk about our application with the three other communities for block grant funds this year, which would be dedicated to housing rehab. And having a community development strategy is a requirement for submitting an application requesting grant funds, community development block grant funds. I can't speak to the history on this because I know you started working on this several months ago and talking about it. And you had one. It has to be updated every several years, and your last one was done for 2010. Let's see, did I give all of mine away? Here. Do you have copies? I left some here.
Oh,
for
yeah,
people.
We have a copy.
No, I'm all set, but
okay.
I left extra ones for any public who might be here. So this was developed, it's mostly a compendium collection of activities the town, particularly planning activities the town has been involved with and plans and what the sustainable development principles are. These are pretty consistent. The guidelines are very much put forward by the Department of Housing and Community Development. So I cannot speak to how these strategic action plans and priority project list was developed, but perhaps, Carolyn, you might have a longer history on this and you could talk
to us. Well, I think basically what this is really just a list of stuff that we participated in over the last few years. And we made every effort to try to pull things together and have a big picture. And we just haven't had a lot of time to devote to it. That's why it's been
Well, I did
hasn't been updated.
Yeah. I did send this round to everybody. A couple weeks ago, I think I sent it to all boards and committees that, and all department heads. So, and I'm not sure I got any feedback, but that's what tonight's meeting about is about as well, is to have a public hearing and get additional feedback on this. I did update one thing. I found out just today that we no longer needed to have a targeted area for house, for our block grant purposes. Previously, the FY10 plan, or the, yeah, it is it was FY10, required that we have a area that's the low and moderate income area of the town, designated as a target area for activities. We no longer required to do that, so I removed it. This allows us to have more freedom to serve people in the entire community. So, but I did not get feedback on the priorities, but perhaps folks who are here tonight or you would like to speak to any of those?
I guess I'm thrilled that we at least had somebody come. So what
Wendy, do you have any other copies?
I can run off some copies if you want.
Oh, yeah. You can have my copy here. Yeah, it's fine. It's really a list of all the things we participated in or have been participating in. And so I guess I'd just like to hear what you have, your input. If you want to adjust anything or focus on anything. Anybody? Oh, okay.
Please.
No. Kathy, why don't you go ahead?
If you have comments, it would be helpful to have you come up. Okay. And introduce yourself for the...
Yes.
Thank you for coming, Kathy.
Yeah.
Well, I've been here several times because, as you know, Kathy Melnick, because of my concern about the, you know, the trees and the sidewalks, and this is the first time I've seen this, so... I did notice that, and I know you have done work on the South Deerfield Town Center and the streetscape, and I realized that there's, if you look under this that topic streetscape, there's nothing really about trees, you know, they're being taken down. I see that more of that happening, which is great, but... there's nothing being planted. You know, that's a concern. I've had a bunch of articles from the town of Greenfield. I think you probably saw them, editorials about how important the trees are to the, you know, just the environment in general. And so that was a concern of mine. And still the sidewalks in Old Deerfield. And I don't know where this all falls. And that one north end of town on the west side still doesn't have a sidewalk, piece of a sidewalk. I mean, you can't even walk there. It's mud.
Yeah.
I mean, nothing's been replaced. And I guess my other question, too, is since the utilities are doing work there and they're really digging that up around the Memorial Street, is all that going to be replaced by them, or what's happening with
all
that?
Well, it should be, but we should have someone check on them.
Because it's really rough through there, you know. Mm-hmm. The dirt I can understand because they can't do anything with it, but at some point, you know, just like to make sure, because that's another bad area, just turning on from Memorial Street to go north on Main Street, and you know, it's always been an issue.
Which street is that, Kathy?
Memorial Street in Old Deerfield.
Okay.
That's where the Old Town Hall is, community center.
Yeah.
But they're doing all kinds of, underground
facilities
work
kind of thing?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they're digging it up, and
you know what? I'll follow up with Kevin on that to make sure that the utilities are
planning.
They're supposed to replace everything. But I'm not sure where we are on the sidewalk issues because I know we were trying to get donations or have the nonprofits as they. Because they do a lot of work up there,
mm-hmm.
and when they are doing renovations, we ask them to, you know, replace parts of the sidewalk.
And they do.
And
this is one section that's not in front of, that just hasn't been addressed. There's no sidewalk at all there. and you can't even walk because it's mud.
Yeah, no, I know which one.
And you said that's the north side?
North, no, west side, north end.
Okay.
When you, just before you turn to go.
To go down to the meadows.
Oh, I see.
North meadows.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been mud for years. So, and it's really a bad section up there, you know, just before the farm. And probably from the north, that north end to the Deerfield Inn is really a bad section.
Yeah.
And.
Well, and I know we have not, because of budgetary issues, we have not been investing in planting trees, and maybe we should do that again. Mm-hmm. I mean, I certainly would love to do that, but.
Well, you know, I know when Doug was here, they did the big planter thing. Maybe it should be turned around and do a tree.
Yeah.
Plant a tree instead of, a planter thing, which is a more permanent. And then no one has to, you know, maybe take care of
maintain
it the first
it.
Year because it needs to be watered or whatever. And at least to replace the ones that are taken down on town property.
Yeah.
Not necessarily, you know, adding new ones for houses and like they used to do, but.
Well, we are starting the budget process, so we'll see what we can do. I mean, we're already went to the governor's. I mean, we went to the MMA conference, and we were supposed to get a 3.9% increase, but the cherry sheets that Wendy just printed out a few minutes ago show us a couple thousand dollars, a couple hundred thousand dollars short. So, from last year, so. I'm not saying that it's a difficult year like we had 3 or 4 years ago when we had major, major deficits, but we're just going to have to look at it because, of course, there just are a huge amount of priorities all the time.
Right, but like I said, for
a
creative way is maybe approach
the
businesses or individuals.
Absolutely. Instead of a planter, plant a tree.
To plant a tree in memory of somebody or something or,
something that sucks up
just
some carbon.
Instead of the flowers, which are
and
which
that
are
could
very
be
nice.
Part of, and that can be part of our mitigation because
exactly.
we need to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I've been trying to think of ways. I know budgets are tight and everything else. And,
that's a good thought.
That is an excellent thought, and we will pursue that because, I was really impacted by that meeting that we were, I was so focused on adaptation and the costs that we were incurring because of these storms that I never really had the time or the energy to think of mitigation. And since we aren't getting any federal help, we have to act locally. We need to focus on the mitigation part too. So. Thank you, Kathy.
Just a thought. And
okay,
no, actually, we really will pursue
it. Sure.
And we're hoping we can sign Wendy tonight, so maybe we can start doing something a little besides just keeping the town together.
Yep.
We can do some real
productive,
good things.
I've been watching your meetings on TV and even the Finance Committee, and it seems like they're having a hard time getting their budgets and everything together, too.
Yes.
So.
Well, if there's no one doing them, it's pretty tough.
We're covering it.
No, I know.
I'll get to talk about that a little bit later.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
That was just a quick glance at this.
No, it's a good thought.
Thank you, Kathy. Did you ladies? Sharon. You can come on up.
A little bit of this and that. I see a lot on here as far as seniors are concerned. Kathy brought up sidewalks. That was something that I actually was concerned about. Had a conversation in the senior center about it today. We have 4 local seniors that come to the senior center on scooters.
Oh, nice.
And it seems to
it's
be
really
something
hard.
That's starting to take off.
Yeah, keeps
and
people mobile.
And they, fortunately, they live local, so they can hop on. But their biggest complaints are our sidewalks. They're afraid of tipping.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
kind of thing.
Are they motorized scooters?
The electric scooters.
What?
They should be on the road.
You know,
anyways.
Some are good up to 8 hours, 10 hours.
Sidewalk.
Electric scooters.
Yeah.
Right. But I was just saying they should be on the road anyways.
They're on the sidewalks.
I know they are, but that's against the law. So.
There's something there, but.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
I wanted to research that as far as the laws and everything else were concerned.
You should talk to the police chief.
Do you know him?
No comment.
He'll know.
But yeah, I agree.
I was just saying to these ladies tonight, state of Florida, of course, they have their own lanes. We have bike lanes, but we don't have scooter lanes.
I know it. It's amazing.
But we're the small town of Deerfield, and, you know, they want to come in the worst way. They can't drive cars anymore.
Yep.
But they can ride on a scooter, and you'll go to Walmart, you'll see them everywhere.
Yeah.
So, anyway, that was one of the things that I wanted to look at. Senior housing has been a big issue.
Yep.
We all know that.
Yep.
Yep.
Every day, I spent a lot of hours today between three different seniors' homes between Sunderland, Whately, and Deerfield. Yeah. And it's overwhelming some days.
Sure.
That senior housing is important.
Very
and
important.
Sharon, I am really excited that we're moving ahead on it, but I also want to say that Trevor and I found out, and we were talked extensively with Sunderland, and they had very much a success with their bidding out of their senior complex. Mm-hmm. And so we're very excited about that happening here. We're going to see how that moves forward, and we're going to try to copy it.
That is great. We're trying to keep our seniors in our houses as long as we possibly can.
And then
over the weekend, I had wood delivered to one home. That was something I wanted to talk about because we had talked about it before. Because our town's crews are cutting down trees here and there. And if we had a site at the landfill or someplace where we could call and say, hey, you know, can we get wood for this particular person?
Right.
And utilize some of that because I don't know where it goes.
Yeah.
So that's been in the back of my mind for a while. So I just paid $380 for wood for a senior.
Yep.
Another one, I've got oil going to tomorrow, 150 gallons of oil. Yep. So these are some of the needs for our people here.
Right.
Is there fuel assistance still, Sharon?
They've used that up.
Yep.
It's been a cold winter. I had a lady today that was kind of huddled up in the senior center because she was cold. And I said something about her heat, and she said, I can't turn it up, Sharon, because I can't afford it.
Yeah.
She said, and I'm cold. And I said, well, how about I have some oil delivered to you? And she said, you would do that for me? And I said, yeah, try it.
Yeah.
We have an account, and we can do some of those things for outreach to them. So that's the lady I'm having the oil delivered to tomorrow. But it's other things, too.
Yeah.
I mean, we just spent $650 on coal for a man to
coal?
Keep him warm. I didn't know anybody in Deerfield burned coal, but they do.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. Uh-huh. And it was to the point where he couldn't get any more because he couldn't afford to pay what he already owed. So we caught up with that and had more brought to him. But these are some of the things that go on under our nose right here.
Yeah, there's a lot going on.
And a cry for food, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got a food thing going, but we're looking down the road. What are we going to do with them?
Right.
Sharon,
a lot of them are
you
to
know
the point
we've
where
spent
they can't
hours
stay in
and
their
hours.
Homes.
I know. We're
we
that kind of thing.
Right.
We're absolutely
I saw the winterization
working on
there.
Yeah.
You know, we've done some of that too. I've worked with some of the high school kids to get them in to the senior homes because the sports teams have to do community projects.
Right.
And so anyway, they come to me and they look for different things to do. So that's worked out awesome.
That's great.
But it's time to move our town forward in many ways.
Yep.
So I wear that hat for the seniors, but my heart is with the library too.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we want to move on, do some good things there, have a lot of people use the library, a lot of young children there, and We're hoping to move our project forward with the support of everybody here, and we know there's a lot on the plate for the town of Deerfield right now, and we're working really hard on this project, and I'll let Nancy explain a little more of that.
But first, my name's Nancy Maynard, I'm chair of the Board of Trustees, but I want to support all that Sharon said about the efforts for seniors. I've worked for 20 years in elder services, and so, you know, I know firsthand, I was on the senior housing committee for 10 years here, that we never really got anything off the ground, and,
yeah.
You know, it's a significant disappointment when you work and, you know, you're trying to find solutions to everybody every day. It doesn't matter whether it's Deerfield or whether it's Franklin County, Hampshire County, or whatever. The issues are all the same, and they do take a lot of continued oversight to, you know, make sure that we compensate for them when we can. As far as the library is concerned, we don't have specific questions or concerns, but we wanted to find out how the library fits into this particular plan.
Mm-hmm.
We will be submitting our grant to the Mass Board of Library Commissioners for the building project tomorrow. It will be hand-delivered. And then we'll be finding out the end of July the status of that. You know, many of the areas that are listed here are areas that will impact the library with parking, with the trees in the library property and those kinds of things. And wanted to get some sense of, you know, how the library project is viewed into this particular plan.
Actually, it's not even listed, is it?
No. and we thought also, you know, the library had done a needs assessment.
Wendy, shouldn't we have that listed?
As I said, I just arrived on the scene.
No, I know. But, I mean, shouldn't that be part of the...
Yeah,
sure.
Can we?
You know...
Thank you, Ken.
That's the kind of feedback we're getting.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
up to the board to make the final decision. And we'll have a, you know, we'll talk about it tonight, and then the final acceptance would be next week. But it seems... Looking at these project areas, it looks like social services would be an area that would fit
yeah.
in.
I would imagine,
chart.
Yeah. And so, you know, we did, you know, as part of the planning and design, there was, you know, another library needs assessment that was done, the long-range plan that the libraries had, you know, for many, many years that's continually updated. So those kinds of things have been done. We've brought those to the select board as we've updated those. So... And certainly, we feel like we've done our job to keep you informed about those.
Oh,
you
absolutely,
have. No
you have.
That.
And I'm sorry. No. I'm just sorry that it isn't here.
Carolyn, did we have a long-range plan way back when?
Yes, but we haven't updated it.
Oh, okay.
If you go back to the front of this, all our plans are outdated.
Because I thought at one point I was on a streetscape.
We had an open space plan. We had a whole townwide plan, master plan.
Yeah,
the only place that's really mentioned is under resources. It just says library programs.
Yeah, I think our master plan. I did the open space plan in 89 and 99.
I remember that.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think. We ever, 2005. We did update it in 2005, didn't we?
This was 2000, the master plan.
Yeah, no, the 2004.
Oh, four, the community
yeah,
development.
Yeah, the open space was 2006. So we did do the open space plan in 2006, but the master plan that we did for 2000, it was really 99. That's when we started the senior housing
mm-hmm.
committee.
Right.
The master plan... as you remember, was an awful lot of work.
Yes,
and
I remember.
it was before I was a selectman, so it was okay. I didn't mind spending the time, because that was like the only focus. But quite honestly, the requirements
task.
Now are even more. And so when I brought, I do remember when 2009, I think, was a horrible year for our budget, and I had brought forward a proposal to update our master plan, because obviously it expired, or was expiring. But we had a huge deficit. We had $400,000 or $500,000 deficit just to start the year off, and that was one of the things that just never. And quite honestly, it's been so busy. We've had so many things going on, you know. And then we had Irene and terrible. I mean, we just had one thing after another. So the master plan never percolated beyond not being expired. So it's been expired for expired for like 7 years now. So it's only good for 10 years. So it was a 2000 to 2010.
Isn't this chart on the back of it part of it? Mm-hmm. And I noticed that there's two places. One across senior service needs, support of Deerfield Council on Aging, Meals and Wheels programs and stuff like that. And there's another part, social services on implement an aging in place program. I mean, I did see this the other day when we received it, but who did this community development strategy action plan? Was this something that's been ongoing?
Yeah.
Because I see all this, everything is a priority one. So, I mean, everything.
I'm going to be very candid about this.
Yeah.
This, I don't know how much the town develops this and how much the housing authority actually pulls
the housing authority
together.
Well, they collate it.
Collate it. And, and again, I don't know.
Because
how much
if they
discussion.
Didn't do it, we wouldn't. I mean, that's just not.
Right. And it's a good collation to get a sense of what's been done.
Yeah.
But it would be useful to look at the other plans. Now, I remember last time I was here, there was some other planning process going on, a major planning process going on. There was a charrette. There were a lot of people
that
here.
That was the complete streets.
Complete streets.
No, that was done before I got here. So this was about three years ago.
Yeah.
And but I don't see anything with that timeline on
here. 3 years
ago,
was it? Complete
streets. Yeah. No, that complete streets was finished before I was here.
Well, then it was a street, was it? This? I remember coming in about 3 years ago, and they did the Darren Gray was here. He did the
that was complete
streets.
So you're thinking of something else, Wendy?
Well, maybe it's this. It says 2000. I thought it was
streetscape.
It was before I was here. I mean, what I'm talking about was
the most recent planning effort was the complete streets, and the reason why that went forward is because we did actually get a grant. To hire consultants,
but
we were able to do it.
I remember I had that in hand when I read that after I arrived, so it was some other engagement process. At any rate, so I'm going to be very candid, which is this matters, but it doesn't matter. It's necessary, but why not make use of it? Why not make it something that is meaningful in it? It reflects things. The problem is this just came to my attention very recently that we need to have this done in order to submit the block grant. But it's an ongoing thing, and we could work on this. And it really, the effect of it really isn't necessarily reflective of what you end up doing or what you decide priority-wise, other things. It's to inform the kinds of things this block grant would fund. It doesn't fund all of these things. It doesn't fund libraries, for instance. But, you know, I'm looking at this, and I know that you've applied for other library grants to get to this point. That should be in here, because you did receive them for design and things.
And we weren't trying to short you, because really, it wasn't us that put this together, so they weren't aware that you were doing so much outreach in the community. So I'm sorry.
But you could tell me what those are, and I could fit that in the resources, at least, you know, because you've received grant money for that work. And then it's up to the board to look at this with feedback from the community and the boards and committees to prioritize and include in the project priority list.
Yeah,
so,
it's time to move our town forward.
Yes.
Seems like we've been at a standstill for so long.
Yes,
other
we
towns
have.
All around us are doing different things. And I'm like, how come their sidewalks are so great? And you know,
I
how
see it
they
all
get
over the
this
state.
And so on and so forth. But I found some paperwork not long ago in my office where I came into the Board of Selectmen in year 2000 and asked for new sidewalks.
Sharon,
and I was assured at that point.
That was before my time. I was on the planning board still.
When Happington was there.
Certainly before my time.
That.
But I have to say, I agree.
They said they were going to, they told Happen that meeting.
Yeah.
You pick an area and start, you know, not patching.
Just redoing.
Redoing. Make new sidewalks. People want to be healthy. They want to walk.
Yes. I hear you.
Walk with children. They want to go to the library with their kids. They want good, safe sidewalks.
I have, in fact, said the same thing, Sharon. This has been multiple orders.
I know. But I see all this good stuff on here, but we need to make it happen.
Yes, we do.
We do.
Yes, we do.
You know, I technology in the library, that kind of stuff. People are coming in. They're looking for that stuff.
Yep.
And this is where we come in to upgrade and
community resources.
And keep our people here.
Agree.
Right.
And keep a good, safe environment for our children to get from point A to point B, because they do come to the library.
After-school programs.
After-school programs and so on and so forth. We need that. And we don't want to lose them to other towns.
Right.
Kind of thing. So we want to keep a great school library. There's an awful lot on this list, so... You got a lot of homework to do here.
We got a lot.
We need hopefully
good community involvement.
I changed some of the dates because it was very ambitious, but I inherited this, so I'm working with what we had.
We are going into executive session in 15 minutes, so.
Oh, okay.
And we are on our way to organizing and getting starting to do stuff now.
Oh, okay.
So when we choose part of this, then we can apply for this multi-town block grant, and do we have to use it for what we suggest, or can we use it for a variety of different things?
Well, that was what he came to talk about last time, and I tried to bring out that there are other things that we could possibly apply for. And actually, in communities that have low and, you know, very areas that have a concentration of low and moderate income people, if you go up to Greenfield or Turner's Falls or other communities that get these grants, they have used them for sidewalk programs. I'm not sure, because I don't know, they change the federal and state requirements each year, whether that would be something we could look at through this program to do sidewalk work or not. But
we have no
the
concentration.
Smaller communities,
we don't have a concentration, right, as you said. So.
And their street lighting is phenomenal. We went to the FCAP meeting the other night and watched Matt get his award. It was awesome, but where John and I parked, it was so dark that I kept looking down at my feet to make sure I wasn't going to fall.
I agree. I travel all over the state. I go to many, many towns in Western Massachusetts, and I'm constantly seeing nice sidewalks, nice, you know, curbs put in, bike lanes, streetscape, you know, the lightings, all new sidewalks. There's a lot going on in a lot of different towns, and it's our time. So we need to, I mean, obviously we have huge other things to work on as well, sewer, a lot of stuff to do. But
you want a good
We can't sit back and just say we've got too much to do, we can't do anything. We got to start prioritizing and get moving.
You want a gateway to Deerfield.
Yes, so we do. This is a wonderful town.
You want, when people are coming to Yankee Candle or wherever, historic Deerfield.
Yeah, they want it to look like a nice town.
Private schools or whatever, you want them to see. You want them to see our great library.
Yeah, absolutely.
And what we do here.
Yep.
Our senior center and so on and so forth.
I agree.
So it's time to make Deerfield beautiful again.
I'm for that.
Thank you. Your red hat.
This is a tool for applying for community development block grant funds.
So you're asking the board include the library.
Under my understanding of what this document is really for. I also would like to see that the library is included in the narrative here.
That's.
And you said you were going to do it.
So then you
they
can be in touch with Sarah, and she can help
They approve.
No, you
it.
Certainly have been planning, and that's part of the you inventory the planning and the other things that are activities that are happening in town. And so we make sure that we will put in. And I'm sorry that You know, they just weren't aware of it.
And would you like me to add a box? Because I can do that.
Yes.
For the library?
Yes, please.
Yes, please.
As a project list?
Yes.
We can help you with the narrative.
Great.
You certainly have put in a lot of effort for planning. If you could get that information on the other, you know, the other grants that you've already gotten, so that we can list them, because that sometimes is very helpful when they see that you are, you know, have gotten like two or three stages of a, on a process, then, you know, there's more likelihood to get money as well. So
sure. I'd be glad
put that down.
That. Great. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
So Wendy, are we required to do anything besides just close the hearing?
Hear from anybody else who'd like to speak.
Oh, is anybody else would like to make a statement? Okay.
Crickets.
So it is, what, 7:20?
Oh, yeah, but it's wonderful. Thank you for signing in. That looks good.
I know.
I mean, we had at least some people
and
show up.
And we will sign it as well.
Yes. Okay.
So then we. So do we just vote on
actually, we're going to put this,
participation
we're gonna,
with this, or?
We're going to have it. I'll bring it back to you.
Okay.
Yeah.
At your next meeting.
Okay.
And that's when we'll.
Maybe somebody else will think of something else that's
right.
been happening.
Who's
I mean,
watching?
We did,
right.
We, you know, we did
it's
this.
On the website. We made copies available.
How about
available.
All the CPA?
Here.
How about all the CPA expenditures we had on playgrounds and cemetery repairs and stuff? Is there sort of
yeah.
Well,
so I did see some cemetery stuff here, but I don't know if it lists.
Well, I think, you know, my heart goes out to what Sharon spoke to as far as the seniors. I mean, you can continually raise money to buy them wood, coal, and oil, but they live in these old houses. It's just
it's too much. It's
away.
Too
so
much.
I'd yeah. rather see us apply for some of this money long before we spend money on cemeteries.
Yeah.
Rehab part of these people's homes, even if it's only a couple of rooms. Get right. one room in their home that can be heated, you know, comfortably,
oh, no,
or a
already,
section of their
that's
home.
That's what
you know?
We said. That's yeah. what we agreed.
This,
that we were going to do this, right? When he was
Brian wait, no,
was here.
I think you're talking about using CPA money then?
Any money, any block grant money we can get. I mean, here
oh,
it
well,
talks
we,
about.
We already have a plan for the CPA money.
Well, we don't need a plan. We need to do it.
No, we'll.
You know?
No.
I mean.
I know, we need to do
here,
it.
I hear about plan after plan after plan after
I know,
plan.
But
the poor people.
We just have to wait a couple more months, and hopefully we'll be able to announce some stuff.
Well, I don't know if this is what you're trying to say, but I, or if I may say this,
sure.
I'm aware of other communities that have augmented because they can only do six units, and they have six people on the waiting list already that augment the kind of activity that they're doing to rehab people's homes with CPA funds.
Yeah.
It's not out of the question. It probably, you know, it's something you can think about.
Well,
you can limit it. It can you can use other guidelines. But I'm if you know.
I think in the next month or two, people will be very pleased with what we have sort of planned. But
for the, just for this, you mean, or
no. Moving forward for
senior housing
and stuff like that.
All right, I guess I'm missing something here.
Well, we'll fill you in.
Okay.
Okay. So we just...
Okay,
do
so
we have
you close the hearing,
the
and
yeah.
I'll adapt this with the comments and...
Yeah, okay.
And get that before you.
So
what else do
for
we
next,
have?
Next
we had
meeting.
Just a quick question. So exactly what's the purpose of this?
So we can participate in the community block grant with the other towns to rehab people's homes. That is what we applied for money, or we agreed to apply for, to participate in, is that income eligible. It's not age eligible. It's income eligible persons can get rehabs done in their house. And Kathy,
you have to have this, or you cannot.
As Wendy said, being
yeah.
very frankly, you just have to do it. You have to. This
it
is a check
may
off
not
the
be
box.
Accurate completely, but you had to have it. Kind of. A
we
plan
have to
set
do
up.
It so that we are eligible. Because hopefully we'll get the money and we'll be investing. We have successfully in the past had opportunities where people's homes, you know, we've had heating systems been replaced, weatherization of and handicap accessibility.
Septic systems, actually, he said.
Yeah. And a septic system was a very big one. That's right. I mean, so we intend to participate again.
So basically, the money you're by doing this, you can apply for any kind of funds, and it will address things on here. So if something wasn't on here, like the library, is that why you wanted to add that to it?
Well, it just, the more activity you have, it makes us look better in the, like we're really trying. I mean, not a lot of money comes into Deerfield. Like everybody was alluding to all the streets, you know, those are community block grants that we're not eligible for. We just don't get them because we don't have the demographics, low-income demographics. That's just the bottom line.
For those other kind of activities, you do need a low and moderate income area of town, and this town, we don't to be competitive for those kinds of projects, infrastructure kind of projects.
But we are competitive for
Housing rehab.
Yeah, housing rehab, because we do have a higher percentage of elders that are moderate low income and that need help. So
and separate from this is like the street stuff, because I know Great Barrington is not one of these really
poor communities.
Poor communities. Mm-hmm. And they've invested a ton in their downtown district. If you ever get a chance to drive through there, it's beautiful. They just finished it up. They raised the church, mm-hmm. you know, way up in the sky. They've done all the streets, all the. So there's got to be some other things that we can reach out for mm-hmm. later on. But this is a little bit separate. This is kind of like showing what we are looking to do and then to get this money to help people with their homes, right? That's what we were focusing on.
Well, related to that, or segueing into that, is we were going to have Jane Treger, possibly other members of the Town Common Committee, come in tonight, but it's been postponed for conflict reasons, schedule reasons, till your next meeting, and that might be a great opportunity to talk more about the sidewalks, complete streets, and where you go from here with the complete streets.
Right.
When I was here before, it had just been completed. No one was talking about it at all.
Right.
And now, since I've been around, I've been hearing it pretty regularly, so maybe.
Well, I think people really want this complete streets to happen.
They do.
And
we need community involvement.
And you know, we went through all the process to, you know, jump through the hoops so we could be eligible. So the problem is there's contribution. It isn't free money. So we might get some help, but then we have to also have a contribution. And so
there were monies, and there might still be monies, but I have to check on that with planning, FERCOG planning.
Okay. Well, we'll close the hearing. Do we need to vote to close the hearing, Wendy?
Or? Why not?
Okay.
Make a motion to close the public hearing.
I'll second the motion.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
We're not going to vote on
this. We're not going to vote on this tonight, right, Wendy?
We'll take that to you.
Yeah.
Okay.
It shouldn't say HRA, by the way.
Okay. I wasn't quite sure what that was. That's fine. So do you want us to vote to designate a member to be signatory for town warrants, vote for substitute signatory in the absence or inability of this?
Right. This is part of the municipal modernization bill, and I want to thank Town Clerk Barb Hancock for bringing this to my attention. To update the law and streamline the operations of local government, among many other things, allows the board, select board, to designate one of you to be the signatory for town warrants, but then you're also required to come back and make a little report at your next meeting about anything related to that, any questions you had about it or whatever.
Okay.
So you don't have to, you know, scramble a bit for that. And it's probably a good idea to vote, and it allows also for a vote for a secondary person in the event the primary person isn't available to come in to sign the warrants.
Oh, Jeff and John and Skip, I'm sorry to interrupt you. Wendy has the cherry sheets here. Did you, they're just hot off the press. And actually,
I forwarded to Skip.
Oh.
But I can send them to.
If you wanted to copy them, you guys could have a copy right now. Because there is, it's about $200,000 less.
Yeah.
And here I had just told you that we were going to have it, you know, the governor was estimating a 3.9% increase. We actually are, because school choice is down, our cherry sheets actually are a couple hundred thousand dollars less.
But don't hang your hat on it. Don't, you know, as we know, this is the governor's proposal.
This is the governor's budget.
This is usually not as generous as past governors. So then it goes to the Senate and the House and reconciliation, all of that. So you know that.
Yeah.
But this,
I'm fine with it. Because it's only the beginning. We're going to have three or four renditions.
I see.
The main thing.
What they're reimbursing? It's going to be about $800,000.
So basically a 50-50?
No. You know what? It is going to be a little more than that because they do match the OPM and the thing. So it might be closer to $1 million. So.
Okay, from the state. And our end of it would be around 800?
No, ours will be about $1 million as well.
Okay.
Whatever it is.
A little bit more, I think, because.
Because there was a couple things that weren't covered.
There were a few things. And it bothered me because I didn't realize it in the beginning. One was there was a small garage there. Mm-hmm. It really irritated me. I think the price tag was something like $18,000 to shingle that. It's a two-car garage roof.
Still to finalize then.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Well, all right. Thank you.
Yep.
Hey, bye. Sorry, Wendy, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Okay, just if you would be willing to do that, it streamlines the process of signing warrants.
I would make a motion to have the chair as the designated signature for our warrants.
And can't we also add that either the other two could be the.
To allow that, but it just simply said, I don't know.
A secondary designated?
So yeah, it says.
So you can't say two designated secondary persons?
We can ask, but, you know.
Yeah. I would
word it any member of the select board.
No, they have to name the person.
Name all three of us.
I would.
Well, that's what
I
was trying.
Kip, just because he's closer to town, but I'd be happy to be the alternate too. I'm usually gone a lot during the day, but I just didn't want to hold anybody up.
You could designate one primary,
right?
A secondary, and
I'll
do further research. But I read it
yeah.
over and over, and I said, gee, it does seem like they just
want to
because they didn't want to.
Okay,
know.
Well, right. It makes sense to name the chair.
Yeah,
and then. Why don't we name Kip secondary?
That's fine.
And then, because actually you do that anyway, which is lovely. You come in,
yeah.
Both of you. So it's just wonderful. I mean, between the three of us, we were able to sign off,
yep.
you know,
yeah.
on everything. But it does make sense. If it's possible to name Trevor as well.
But if not, yeah, I just figured I'm usually out of town most days, but I
yeah,
just
but
didn't want to.
You cruise through a lot.
I do cruise through a lot, but I just wanted yeah. to make sure if there was a, you know.
So, okay.
Whatever.
I think we got it covered.
Okay.
So we're making a motion to do me, the chair, whoever
yep.
the chair is, that happens to be me now, and then Kip. And then if we rotate the chair this next year, then it should be both of you guys.
Well, the other reason
I'm at
you know,
the far end of
Kip,
town.
Well, Kip is on for 3 years. I'm only on for one at the time. So I think it makes sense that.
All right. Well,
so
it's just.
Far.
I don't.
If we go into rotation, the proper rotation is for me to be chair my final year.
Right, correct.
Right. So, but we'll discuss that in May at this point. There might not be a final
we'll
year.
We'll have a paintball gunfight over it.
The thing is, I think we get along really well, and we back each other up, and,
yes.
and who cares?
Yep.
And I'm just so thrilled I don't have to do notes anymore in minutes. Oh, my God.
Yeah, I'm thrilled, too.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Hopefully I'll have your I'll have more minutes for you next time.
Oh, Wendy, hopefully you can pass it on to someone else.
They were good.
They were good. They were good, really good minutes.
Oh, that means everything to me. No, seriously, I work so hard.
I know you do.
It's a lot of work to do minutes.
You don't have to work so hard because Carolyn's were.
Yeah. All right. I know.
I can't help myself.
Hey, I worked really hard on them too.
I'm sure you did.
Well, it's very challenging to do when you're participating.
I was always like, my hand is still like.
Plus, you're informal. So you talk, cover multiple subjects at one time.
Group here. So I made a motion. Anybody else?
Second. If there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Got
it's
it.
Unanimous. Okay. Two new things, two other additional items on the that we need to vote on. And then we're going to go into executive session. So we need to appoint Michelle Camosa to the Personnel Board. So I make a motion to thank.
Second.
Thank her and make a motion that she does it quick.
Second, really fast.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
You're going to abstain.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Michelle. That is
thank
really
so
wicked
much,
nice.
Thank you so much, Michelle.
I appreciate it. And then we're going to appoint Joseph Miskowski as our part-time police officer, effective February 6, 2017 to June 30th. 2017.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I just want to explain to people, he is our part-time police officer right now, but he's retiring from UMass, and so he needs to retire completely from us as well.
Yeah.
So he's retiring, and then we are reappointing him so he can continue to work here in Deerfield, which we are very appreciative
very
of with his experience and longevity here. Thank you.
Yes.
Wendy, did you have a town minister's report that you wanted to?
Oh, yeah.
To
one other thing. Is that a moderator reappointment or? I'm sorry.
What was that?
Kitty James.
Oh, I don't have that.
I got bridge inspection.
Okay, well.
I'm sorry, I don't.
See is there an extra copy of. Okay, you're looking at two things there.
I have the bridge report.
That's what I have.
Okay. We'll go to that. I'm just giving that to you for your information to look at. And
okay, great. It's working. I drive over it all the time.
This is the
they do a report of the state of all our bridges in town. So.
And Kip, you wanted to talk about the well report, monitoring report you read.
Sure.
I really appreciate that.
Yep.
That just came in.
Yep. I reviewed the annual post-closure monitoring report for the Lee Road landfill, and I'm happy to say that everything is going along as it has been over the last couple of years. They tested all the wells and found no new contamination.
Great.
And no new spreading of, I guess they call it the plume.
Plume.
They tested the water wells on the Melnick farm, and they found everything was within the EPA limits for drinking water. And
right.
So I guess it's good. We'll just continue on forward.
Very nice.
They also located a well that had been, I'm not sure if it was run over or lost, but they installed a new monitoring well on the landfill.
Okay.
And there's no problems with that as well.
Great.
Good.
Picked in here. So.
Great.
Thank you. Sure. Thank you very much.
The only thing I want to mention is that I met with Scott Paul, the IT guy and IT director at Frontier, and he gave me a tour of all their IT infrastructure because I'm working on that IT grant to get high speed to get it. We have a grant to recap. We have a grant to spend by June 30th to get some high speed backup, off storage backup for our computer systems in the town hall. And right now, Frontier also has a need for, and the school systems have a need for off-site backup because now that they're the superintendent's office and central office is now at Frontier. Everything is in one building. So if they have a fire, they hit by a tornado, whatever it might be, all that data is in one spot. They do periodic backups, but because the amount of data can only travel, it's going over like a 10 megabyte line. So I could have this wrong, megabit line. It's not very, it would take like a whole weekend and a day to get
backed up, and they can only back up so many things at a time. Technology is changing. A lot of wireless is changing, so a lot of infrastructure is changing there. I also met with, or I made quickly contact with a guy from Phoenix, and I have his card and another guy from that runs from Axios, who run and manage the MBI
yes.
fiber optics. So I've gotten an email. We exchanged emails real quick. I'm going to hopefully get up a meeting quickly in the next week or so to just discuss the infrastructure. And I would love to get a fiber optic high speed from the town to Frontier, because that's really the best place to have infrastructure out of all of our other buildings. They have a great room. It's air conditioned. It's safe. It's locked, secured, clean, no dust. So we would love, and they would love to have some backup as well. So if we can get a line.
Where would we put it here?
I was thinking either, well, wherever our servers are, either in the EFCOT room or here as well.
We were talking about their insecurity.
They're not
secure. Let's not talk about it.
Yes. So
we're talking about possibly that room in there.
Right. When that
we're
going to
talk with
up.
FCAT about.
So, we need to work on our infrastructure with all our town buildings and all that technology, because we're spending a ton of money on this. And if we can find ways to streamline it, make it quicker, less money, we own it kind of thing. So I want to kind of get my hands around the budget
of
all of that stuff.
I know you were mentioning
and
a
just
huge
speed
impact.
And having good data backed up. Because more and more we're using data. So I just wanted to give an update on that, and
that's
we're
great.
Getting
yes,
close to
thank you.
Getting some more info.
I am so appreciative of you doing that. It's a lot of work trying to figure out
it's
what to do. But
good info.
And are they going to give an estimate or something?
Yes.
Like okay.
So I'm going
to have to go out to bid.
Yes. I'm going to get in touch with Phoenix. He's going to tell me what they do now.
Right.
Because this guy's in charge of all that for the area. Two guys. And so I'll get a full understanding of what they do, what they can do. Then we'll go out to bid, and we'll figure out. The first thought that Doug had was to trench to the Deerfield Elementary School. I think it's better to go aerial through the poles. But we'll get an idea on whether that's the best case or not. And can we go through the poles and all
and
that.
And because of the grant, I think said Senior Center or something, I'll just need to work
that
out.
Yeah, we'll clean all that stuff up. Yep.
I just found the... Kitty James's resignation from Franklin Tech. So did you want us to announce that there was a Franklin Tech opening?
Yeah, people have said to me,
that we'll
do you know anybody? And, so put the word
we'll
out.
So we'll announce that the moderator is the one that appoints the Franklin Tech person, but... If anyone is interested in the Franklin County Technical School District committee, we have a term that needs to be filled out. Thank you. And Kitty, thank you very, very much for years and years of
service
and work on this board. Thank you so much. Okay.
One thing I just wanted to mention is that the I'm working on this letter to go out to the residents of the Captain Lathrop Drive community. And over the last couple of weeks, we had another pump failure there that cost us a lot of money, and it was $6,000-$7,000. And it's primarily caused by, these disposable wipes and things that should not go down the toilets or the garbage grinders or whatever. And that the people from Captain Lathrop Drive will... soon be getting a letter outlining the problem and some of our proposed solutions to that.
Okay. Thank you. Is there anything else before we go into executive session?
Well, I just was going to mention these budget books are being put together. Brenda's been doing them. We have a few budgets in them. I think you've seen them already.
Yep.
Going to keep them in the office because they're coming in more and more. We want to just fill them up. Because if you take them out, then, it would be easier to just keep them in and add to them when we have the big budgets in. I did get, Bob Decker gave me a budget that is, he said it's a 3% increase from Frontier. It hasn't been voted on yet, but I think I might have put them in your books, not punched holes in it yet, but
yes,
so you can take a look at that. Yep. So that's it. Just want to thank our accountant, town accountant, Brenda Hill for all the work she's doing on this, and
great job.
I so Skip appreciate as well. Everything.
I said our understanding was, you know, they asked me a while ago, you know, who's going to do this, what, and I and Skip wanted to get going on this from the Finance Committee, and said, go ahead. So if that's okay with you, they've already started looking at things, and I understand, and I was going to go through this with you, but you don't have them in front of you. There is a few of these smaller budgets that they've already looked at and recommended. So
I was at the Finance Committee meeting last night to watch that process and see them go through that, and they did approve some, and they've got some on hold. They'll ask, like, the police department to come in and all that, so mm-hmm. talk about their budgets. So, yeah, it's great. Collected. Moving forward.
To the budget that you just spoke about, there's a 3% increase. I think I had asked for, and I'm sorry I forgot, but how does the school deal with their health insurance? Does Frontier, you know, is the health insurance part of their budget, or is that separate?
No, that's part of their budget.
Were they aware of the increase coming their way?
I don't know. Let's see.
Is the majority of the town's employees are at Frontier?
We have the elementary school. About two-thirds of our health care budget is
just the elementary school. So when I look at our figures of the $800,000, that does not include Frontier?
No. Okay. That's just the elementary school in our town.
Okay.
I have to find the
I do know, now that you mentioned, I was aware that School Union 38 was another unit of the Hampshire County Group Insurance
Trust.
That's
Frontier.
So even though our elementary school is run by that school district, they're still town employees, not district employees? Is that correct?
It's a union. It's not actually a district, yes. Which is another entity. And the school unions, and there's the other one.
Are our teachers unionized?
No, it's actually doesn't. It's not. I'm not using that term.
It's a different kind of union.
It's an old, ancient grouping of towns. For instance, Leverett, Shutesbury, Leverett, Shutesbury, Irving, Wendell, New Salem. I think are all in. Yep. We're in 38. They're 28.
Yeah. They're 28 or 38.
And it's not. It's not a district. It's almost like a district, but the employees are town employees rather than district employees. So it's a union for the purposes of sharing a superintendent and a superintendent.
That's what, to me, it just seemed a little confusing because if the Deerfield Elementary School teachers are Deerfield employees where their benefit package comes through our budget, they're still guided and controlled through School District 38.
Mm-hmm.
They have the same superintendent as Frontier and stuff like that. So that's what confused me is why Frontier's teachers were not also our employees.
How many students, how many staff?
That's just the way the union, school unions versus school districts are set up. There was some discussion today about whether we would take another look at segregating out the school benefits part of the health insurance portion of our budget. So you would know distinctly what the elementary school part of that is. It's
The Hampshire Trust. I mean, the Hampshire Trust is really, really good, and they. Yeah. I mean, there's nothing. The prescription drugs are up like 5,000%. I mean, there's nothing they can do. Year after year after year, they're better than the GIC, which is the state one.
Barbara Hancock, wearing her other hat as a treasurer, showed me. She's been working on the figuring out what she should put together for health insurance, and showed me a dramatic increase in the health insurance for the school employees.
Yeah.
based on additional personnel, primarily.
We had year after year after year of no increase.
Oh, but this has to do with numbers rather than the actual increase.
Yes, well, we have numbers, and that's not an issue. I mean, that is an issue, but we had years and years and years of no increase to the actual per cost, program cost.
Right.
And last year was a 3% increase. It was really completely related to prescriptions. And my understanding is this increase is the majority is prescriptions again.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that is just gross. I'm sorry. That's just people making money off of, you know, they're taking the patents, old patents, and buying the
drug companies
and then increasing the cost. It's like EpiPens.
We did have a Canada prescription plan when I was in Wilbraham, which is Scantic Valley.
Okay. And Barbara has sent out to all our...
Right.
The information on buying them in Canada.
Mm-hmm. But it doesn't cover all the medications by any means.
No.
Doesn't cover all the medications by any means. It's limited. It's limited.
CVS did come out with a generic brand of EpiPens.
Oh, they did?
Yeah, under $100.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, good. I think that's terrible. That's a life-saving thing.
Yep.
And
yeah.
You have to rotate them.
Those are
awful.
And they're expensive because... Even if you don't use it, but you need it handy, they expire in time, so you have to keep buying them.
Yeah,
I know. I think it's terrible.
And the truth is, maybe they don't expire.
Yeah,
I know.
But you can't risk it.
No.
Doesn't EMS, do they have them as well?
Yes, they do. Yep, schools.
So it's a cost there as well.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, but the whole...
Big cost.
I mean, over the years, people, you know, all the schools have them and stuff, but they have to throw them away after they've expired, then you have to buy them again, and... They've gone up like 1,000. Yeah, that one gross guy.
Yep.
Anyway. Oh, okay. So.
Motion to adjourn?
We're going into executive session.
Okay.
The select board may enter into executive session as allowed by MGL Chapter 30A, 21, Section A, 6 to consider the. Wait.
Yeah, I don't know how it got back on there. I just had the one executive session on there. Number two, number eight, number B.
Okay, the select board may enter into executive session as allowed by Mass General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21A3-3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation if an open meeting may be detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigating position of the public body, and the chair so declares, and I do declare. Okay.
I, Trevor McDaniel.
Oh, no, you got to make a motion first.
Oh, I thought you made that motion.
No.
It's not making it. So I make a motion to go into executive session.
I'll second the motion.
All those in favor? Oh, no, wait.
I, Trevor McDaniel.
I, Carolyn.
We'll get this down.
I, Henry Camosa.
Oh, my God. All right.
We're going to figure this out.
And we are going to go home afterwards.
Just say you come out and announce your decision after this.
Oh
yes,
okay.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Welcome back to the January 25th, 2017 Select Board meeting. And we will announce that we have Wendy full time on board starting
so much,
2 minutes
Wendy.
Ago. Yay!
Yay! It starts tomorrow.
Oh, true, it does.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Very, very much.
We're trusting in us.
I have to tell you, I'm so relieved. So you will now post for your executive assistant, or you have.
Yes,
already
I'd like to do that, and I'm going to be meeting with the. And I gave you all a heads up with the personnel board, including the personnel board, about wanting to talk about what job description we're using. They've updated them, but they're not. They haven't been accepted, but I'd like to see what they've done and what we've got already, and. Take a look at that together.
The only thing that Trevor and I had talked about, because of that strategies and emergency management and different, I think you went to a class. Anyway,
social media.
We really felt that we wanted that person to have a real task in being in charge of social media.
Facebook, Twitter.
I don't think we have to be like Duxbury where they have the emergency Twitter, and then they have the regular Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that the police have the Facebook, but
they do a good job.
And they do a good job. But I feel like we've got to have ways to reach out if there's an emergency, but just in general, so
in
people
general.
Feel connected and know us as a community and be involved.
Mm-hmm.
You can't we can't recruit new people and we can't get people to be informed if we have problems like with our website.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a whole generation that
communicate differently.
That do not sit and watch this movie, this show. Mm-hmm. So whatever you, they're just busy with kids and everything else. But they do check their Facebook often. Mm-hmm. So if we could, you know, and then find ways to bring them into town government or even just, you know, participate in different things we have going on with that building up downtown and whatever.
But just like Code Red on our on our website, it says Code Red. Well,
it doesn't say what it does.
It doesn't say what it does. It doesn't say sign up here.
Yeah, we'll have to get back to some of that information that was on the website previously. Yes. The switch in
and mobile friendly.
This website is just not good.
I was looking for old minutes and
One of the things we want in that assist, I mean, obviously you have a lot of needs for them, but we just felt I really wanted some social
that
media.
That would be a new, like, we wanted to add it on. And that was, again, probably more emphasis from this meeting. Mm-hmm. Than
well, I'll come back to you and talk about the position and the process and who's going to be involved in that kind of stuff. So.
Okay.
Great, right.
Sounds good.
And your thoughts are always welcome, of course.
And I just want to re-mention that we had talked about changing our meetings till Tuesday. We're going to end up, Wendy's not doing her music this at least through the summer or the summer, and there's only actually a couple conflicts with Trevor, so we will be moving only a couple meetings and then we'll stick to our Wednesdays just so it doesn't mess up the warrant. So our next meeting is February 8th at 6:30 and February 22nd for the month of February, and obviously if we have issues or budget that we need to have more work, we'll have another meeting. We'll sort it out.
Yeah.
But we'll have two scheduled meetings right now. Is there anything else you wanted to add?
No, I'm good.
Okay.
I get all my stuff in.
Thank you so much, Wendy.
Yes, thank you very much.
Oh, Wendy.
Join us. I'm so excited.
I'm so less stressed already. I'm not kidding.
I have taken it on.
Yes, right. I can imagine. It's got to be a little bit of time.
But I want to thank you both because these guys, I'm not kidding, I've said it before, but I'm saying it again. You guys have been wonderful about chipping in, and there was no way we could have kept the town going with no staff unless department heads, Pat Kroll, Priscilla,
heads, absolutely.
Everybody chipped in.
Everybody
and,
in town
and you guys
has.
Stopped
yeah.
in.
I think
and
Barbara, everybody has
everybody
really stepped
did
up.
A huge amount of work.
Brenda.
And
Brenda. Pat.
But honest to God,
Dick.
I'm so glad
Dick.
To be passing it on.
Dick,
yes, Finance everybody, but I'm so happy to be passing it on.
Yeah, so I'll see you in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Three.
I'll see you tomorrow.
I am sure. Not too early, though.
No. Right.
Yeah. So I'll be
so listen, we've already, I promised Wendy that we would have shorter meetings, so we're already beyond our meeting time. And
this was a special occasion.
A special occasion. Yeah, that's true. Okay, I will take a motion to adjourn.
I make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Good. And Wendy, you can't stay tonight. You got to go home in case it's freezing rain.
Oh.
There was supposed to be a little sprinkle. I drove through.